Hello, my name is Idel. I'm 22 and I have PCOS. I had irregular periods, and after discussing with my mother, who had similar symptoms, I decided to go to my GP as I knew things weren't normal. My GP took bloods and she ruled out other possible causes, so then she referred me to the endocrinologist in Beaumont Hospital. After my consultation with the endocrinology team and after they received my blood results, they diagnosed me with PCOS. I've struggled with my weight for quite a long time, as I found it easy to gain weight and I found it difficult to lose it. This has made me quite self-conscious and has affected my mental health and my relationship with food, especially during my teenage years when I struggled with depression. The path to getting diagnosed for me was easy. However, I know this isn't the case for most other people. I'm glad to be taking part in the clinical research studies, as I know that I am contributing to helping others.
Polycystic ovary syndrome is a common, complex condition that affects up to 10% of all women. It's characterized by elevations of hormones called androgens, irregular periods, and often polycystic appearances of the ovaries on imaging. PCOS can impact on a patient's health in a number of ways. In the past, we would have perceived this primarily as a reproductive disorder that affects ovulation and fertility, but increasingly we are now aware that this is a metabolic condition which is associated with an increased risk of health problems such as diabetes, fatty liver disease, and cardiovascular disease. Weight issues can be challenging to manage in PCOS. We trial lifestyle measures such as diet and exercise. We often use medications such as metformin to help regulate periods and sometimes reduce weight. Increasingly, we are looking at other medications called GLP-1 analogues, which are used in diabetes, but which are also powerful weight loss medications. In a small subset of women, we may refer them onwards for bariatric surgery if their weight is above a certain threshold.
My name's Dr. Anju Johem. I'm an endocrinologist at Monash Health and a senior research fellow at Monash University in Melbourne, Australia. And I'm very pleased to be here in Dublin as part of this HRB-funded project. So in the area of PCOS, we previously did not have any established guidelines. In 2018, we released the first international PCOS guideline, and this has recently been updated this year. The aim of the guideline was to actually get consumers and health professionals together and try and identify some of the key areas that were of interest in PCOS. Then the teams got together and pulled out all the recent evidence and literature in the key identified areas, and they've tried to come up with recommendations so that we have consistent practice in PCOS across the globe.
It's important for gynecologists in training to have a good understanding about the presentation and the management of PCOS. As part of the diagnosis of PCOS, an ultrasound will commonly be performed. This would be in addition to the clinical history taking and the blood test that we would do. And the ultrasound may show some classical features of PCOS. So for example, the ovaries may be a little bit larger than normal. The tissue can be more dense, and we see lots of follicles located in the peripheral aspect of the ovary, which gives the classical ultrasound appearance to diagnose PCOS. So a recent change in the understanding of PCOS is it's a true multi-organ, multi-system disorder. It doesn't just affect the pelvis, it's not just a gynecological condition. So we do need input from endocrine teams, from the metabolic team, possibly from a dietitian. And it's important that we take up that true holistic multi-system approach. So it's important to look at weight, diet, exercise, hormones, not just think about the menstrual cycle and of bleeding. From a fertility perspective, this is very important. And one of the things that we've done in Beaumont is that we have created a joint service between gynecology and endocrinology where we can look at all of these aspects in one combined clinic and provide a more complete service and a more complete level of care for the patients, where we can address both ovulation and the menstrual cycle combined with metabolic issues, looking at weight loss, optimizing insulin resistance, helping with all of these multi-system conditions and trying to get that combined approach in one service.
My name is Tara McDonnell and I'm a clinical research fellow working with Professor O'Reilly in the RCSI in Beaumont Hospital. Hirsutism is a term used to describe excess hair growth in a male pattern, typically affecting the chin, lip, face in women with PCOS. And it can be one of the most distressing symptoms that women suffer from. Treatment often takes multiple approaches. Firstly, hair removal techniques such as plucking, threading, waxing may be utilised, but hair will return. There are creams to reduce the hair growth, and laser therapy can be very effective in reducing hair for certain women, but is limited by cost. This doesn't improve things overnight. It can take some time for improvements to occur. And we also use medications that can block the effect of androgens on the skin. Under the supervision of healthcare workers and using effective contraceptive, these can also be quite effective. Tackling the underlying hormonal disturbance through medication is another option for some women. These don't work overnight, but can be effective over time. This includes the oral contraceptive pill and also medications that block the androgen action at the skin, such as spironolactone. These can be used with effective contraceptive and can help over time. What do we know about some of the less commonly described conditions associated with PCOS? Well, importantly, as we gain further insight regarding PCOS as a condition, we understand it does not just affect reproductive health or metabolic health, but also can affect women in other ways, such as sleep disturbance. For example, women with PCOS have a higher risk of obstructive sleep apnea. This is a condition where women have a propensity to snore overnight and have apneic episodes. And undiagnosed can lead to hypertension and cardiovascular risk later life. We also importantly recognise that mental health concerns in women with PCOS is increasingly important to recognise, such as anxiety and depression. Working with women through this clinical research has improved my work as a clinician through many ways, including collaboration with international experts, practicing evidence-based medicine and critical appraisal, but ultimately and most importantly is working with the women with PCOS and understanding their lived experience of their symptoms helps me as a doctor understand how we need to do better to improve treatment options for women with PCOS. And ultimately, while striving to improve health outcomes for women with PCOS, we need to answer the research questions that are most important for them.
Hi, my name is Leanne Cossin. I am a PhD student and an ICAT fellow working in the RCSI with Professor O'Reilly's group. My area of interest is on how hormones called androgens impact on female health and disease. The most common condition of androgen excess is polycystic ovary syndrome, which is the focus of my PhD study. In order to understand the impact of androgens on muscle metabolism, I'm going to conduct different types of research. Firstly, we will be doing study visits in the clinical research centre where women will come in for a study visit over the course of a day. In addition, we will be doing some techniques in the lab, such as 3D bioprinting, which will be able to replicate tissue models in the lab in order to understand the impact of these hormones on muscle energy metabolism. Historically, PCOS was considered a reproductive disorder only. However, it is now increasingly clear that this is a complex metabolic syndrome. What is less well clear, however, is the impact that these hormones play on muscle energy metabolism. PCOS is a complex disorder that involves hormonal imbalances, metabolic complications, and reproductive disorders. And in order to understand this further, we need a multidisciplinary approach of endocrinologists, gynecologists, and scientists with an interest in metabolism and statistics to work together. Each of these disciplines will provide a unique perspective which will allow us a greater insight into the mechanism and etiology of polycystic ovary syndrome, with the ultimate goal of translational research which brings scientific discoveries from the bench to the bedside in order to implement for practical reasons for the patients.
Hi, my name is Maureen Busby. I'm the CEO and founder of PCOS Vitality, a charity that supports women and people with PCOS. What women find most frustrating about PCOS, there's a lack of treatments for PCOS. There's currently no licensed treatment for it. It is a global problem. It's not just a problem in Ireland. And historically, it has been regarded as a reproductive condition, but we realise now that it affects women across their lifespan. I think clinical efforts need to focus on a timely diagnosis for women and people with PCOS and to focus on how it affects them at different life stages. and to meet their individual needs. We need a proper model of care and to understand more about the emotional impact and have the right support in place for women. We also need some treatments and to know more about the metabolic implications, how it affects our weight and our cardiovascular health and our risk of type 2 diabetes. We know that postmenopausally there's an increased risk of type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and there's also a risk involved with endometrial cancer or womb cancer, and these are very worrying things for patients, and there's very little advice or awareness around those. We also need to know more about how it affects their mental health, both before and after menopause, and how we can perhaps use family and social support in addressing the stigma that it surrounds PCOS and use it in a positive way to lessen the load of what it is to live with it. We also need to know more about the transgenerational effects of PCOS. We know it runs in families. As a patient support group, we also try to engage with local politicians and try to work with government as well and their health departments to push the agenda for PCOS to always be included. And we have recently done some work on this with regards to the Women's Health Strategy in England and also in Ireland. And really, we want to make sure it's a top priority